Good evening, everyone. I'm John Naylor, and I'm chair of RSA Scotland, and I'm delighted to welcome you this evening to the 14th Angus Miller Lecture. It's one of the real highlights of the intellectual and social calendar for fellows in Scotland each year. Now, before we begin, inevitably, there are a few brief notices to bring to your attention. No fire drills are planned, so if the alarm goes off, please leave in an orderly fashion from the two marked exits and assemble at the Princess Street Gardens through that way. There will be staff available to help you. Please could I ask you also to put your mobiles on silent and not take any flash photography. Now, tonight's lecture is being recorded in different media, and details of how to access it will be sent to you, and we encourage you to share it with friends and colleagues. For Twitter addicts, do post your thoughts and comments and get involved in the online discussion using hashtag AML2014, hashtag AML2014. Now, this evening's lecture is made possible thanks to the support of fellows and the generosity of the Miller family, and we acknowledge that support with our very deep gratitude. Thank you, Charles, Roddy, and Philip, who are here tonight, so thank you. Now, one of their aims is to widen the appeal of the RSA, so we'll hope that non-fellows will be moved by tonight's lecture to consider becoming a fellow. There's a short piece about us in the leaflet which we give, in the programme leaflet, and also there's a table with more information, so please have a look before you go. Finally, this is my third and final Angus Miller Lecture as chair of RSA Scotland. While unintended at the time, they formed a mini-series on innovation and learning. The first was Martin Lord Rees, the former Astronomer Royal, who explored the frontiers of our knowledge in space, but also reflected his passion for learning as president of the Royal Society, that's in London, and Master of Trinity College, Cambridge. In the second, we came down to earth, as it were, in the Professor Mark Muir Downich, leading material scientist, explored how our changing understanding materials has impacted on our everyday lives. He too is passionate about encouraging wider learning. His department at University College London is centred around a maker space open to all students. There are many similarities to MacLabs, which the RSA has supported in Scotland, and I haven't got time to go into the detail of makerspaces, so I'm sorry if I've bamboozled you with that language. Mark is also a regular on TV, and the next instalment of his present BBC TV series is broadcast tonight at 9 p.m. So you dash home tonight, you might be able to see it. Tonight, in this third lecture, we'll hear from one of this era's great figures, Professor Joseph Stiglitz, about creating a learning society. We're most grateful that Colin Donald, business editor of the Herald and Times, has agreed to be our chair tonight, and I now hand over to him. So enjoy your evening, and thank you.
Well, good evening, everyone. I'm tempted to go out in front of the podium. So much more effective. When I was 14, growing up in the steel town of Gary, Indiana, on the southern shores of Lake Michigan, I decided that as an adult, I wanted to be a professor, and that somehow I wanted to combine that with some form of public service. A few years later, having fallen in love with economics, those ambitions took shape. I wanted to understand what caused the poverty, unemployment, and determination that I had seen all about me growing up, and I wanted to do something about them. Perhaps I have been able to make a small contribution to what are overwhelming problems. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's my great privilege and pleasure to introduce this year's RSA Angus Miller Lecturer, Professor Joseph Stiglitz, a man who has done more than any writer and teacher to advance and sometimes overturn our age's understanding of the interplay between economics and social justice, just as he set out to do as a young man in the autobiographical piece that I just quoted. As a young man growing up in the Rust Belt of the Midwest, he went on to enjoy one of the most stellar academic and public service careers imaginable. But as you will hear tonight, he has done this while retaining his genius for communicating complex ideas in simple and usually forceful terms. Even a minimalist summary of Professor Stiglitz's extraordinary career as a teacher, writer, and public servant would eat very large chunks out of the time we have tonight, and also time for his talk, and also for the Q&A. So I hope he will forgive this ruthlessly pruned version. But before I do that, actually, a word about Professor Stiglitz and Scotland, a country whose problems, I imagine, and perhaps he will say, are fairly familiar to him from his own post-industrial hometown. Those of you who attended the Edinburgh Book Festival session yesterday morning, featuring Professor Stiglitz in conversation with my Sunday Herald colleague Ian McWhirter, and who saw the many headlines this generated in today's papers, will have noticed that Professor Stiglitz takes very close interest in the debates that are convulsing Scotland at present. And this interest has grown through his membership of the Scottish Government's Council of Economic Advisers, and particularly the Fiscal Committee Working Group, which has recommended the establishment of a sterling zone, or shared currency, with the Bank of England as a central bank of a common British monetary area. This may or may not be something you'd like to talk to him about after his talk. Anyway, his knowledgeable contributions to this debate, expressed, I may say, with considerably more geniality and also economic evidence than was mustered later in the same day by either Mr. Salmond or Mr. Darling, these contributions have never failed to make a big impact on the referendum debate. And they represent a sort of academic answer to Burns's famous prayer, or would some further gifted years to see ourselves as others see us. But of course, this is not just any academic viewpoint, of course. Professor Stiglitz is, along with George Akerlof and Michael Spence, the winner of the 2001 Nobel Prize in Economics, and a lead author of the 1995 IPCC report, which shared the 2007 Nobel Peace Prize. He's also a past winner of the John Bates Clark Medal, awarded to a young American economist under 40. He is currently the university professor at Columbia University, and his dazzling academic CV includes a Fulbright scholarship at Cambridge University, the Drummond professorship at All Souls College, Oxford, and distinguished teaching posts at MIT, Yale, Stanford, and Princeton universities. He was chairman of the US Council of Economic Advisers under President Clinton, and the chief economist and senior vice president of the World Bank from 1997 to 2000, where he famously crossed swords with the US Treasury and the Bush administration as well. Others too, probably. Janet Yellen, who is the current chair of the Federal Reserve Board, is a long-standing, a very old friend, and also a student of Professor Stiglitz, and his successor as chair of chair of the Council of Economic Advisers. His list of publications is prodigious. He has authored and co-authored over a dozen books, and these books are in the rare category of academic economic analysis made accessible for the general reader. In many of his books, he has perfected the art of limpid simplification while at the same time exposing the crude oversimplification and distortions of widely held common sense views of the market and what he calls ersatz capitalism. As I say, over a dozen books, 300 articles. Some of the best known titles include Free Fall, American Free Markets and the Sinking of the World Economy, Mismeasuring Our Lives, Why GDP Doesn't Add Up, The Stiglitz Report, Reforming the International Monetary and Financial Systems in the Wake of the Global Crisis, Time for a Visible Hand, Lessons of the 2008 World Financial Crisis, The $3 Trillion War, The True Cost of the Iraq Conflict, The Roaring 90s, which incidentally is the source of that quote I opened with, Globalization and Its Discontents, The Economics of the Public Sector, a very strong interest of his, Whither Socialism, and Making Globalization Work, which has sold over 2 million copies. His most recent book to appear in paperback, co-authored with Bruce Greenwald, is The Price of Inequality, How Today's Divided Society Endangers Our Future. And it's a great example of Professor Stiglitz's enormous influence as a commentator, that inequality is one of the hot areas of economic research, and of course is the source of his early passion for the subject. It is a subject perhaps related to his interest in the Scottish referendum as well. However, it's his new book that we are privileged to be hearing about this evening at this Angus Miller Lecture, and it's called Creating a Learning Society, a new approach to growth, development, and social progress. It's a return to his long-held interest in the economics of information, the subject that was cited by the Nobel Prize Committee when he received the prize. His new book looks at how the market does and doesn't promote learning and why that matters to an economy. So before I hand over to Professor Stiglitz, I'd like to just quote a bit from the Swedish Academy's citation for his 2001 award. He has clarified the type of market adjustment where poorly informed agents extract information from the better informed, such as the screening performed by insurance companies, dividing customers into risk classes by offering a menu of contracts where higher deductibles can be exchanged for significantly lower premiums. In a number of contributions about different markets, Stiglitz has shown that asymmetric information can provide the key to understanding many observed market phenomena, including unemployment and credit rationing. Well, it's characteristic of Professor Stiglitz that his own summary of the same work was characteristically pithy. Some people, he said, know more than others. So, on that note of undoubted truth, it's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Joseph Stiglitz.
Well, it's a real pleasure to be here. It's especially exciting to be in Scotland right now at this time. A lot of interesting issues are being discussed. The subject, though, of my talk this evening is creating a learning society. For more than 2,000 years, standards of living stagnated, caught between slight improvements in technology and the forces of Malthusian population increases. All this changed about 250 years ago. Since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, standards of living have soared. And if you show a graph, data 2,000 years ago are not that great, but basically they show a consistent pattern, basically nothing changing. And then suddenly, around 200 years ago, in some places in Europe and then successfully other places around the world, you see almost a J curve. It just shoots up. Today, the typical person lives better in many respects than royalty did hundreds of years ago. This has led economists to ask, to what do we attribute these remarkable increases in standards of living? What caused this dramatic change? There are three explanations that have been put forward. The first is capital accumulation that people save. And by saving enough, productivity increases. The second is improvements in allocative efficiency, getting better in managing resources. And the third is learning to do things better, to get more outputs from a given amount of inputs. The evidence is overwhelming that the latter is responsible for the overwhelming bulk of the increases in standard of living that I described earlier. In short, the transformation to what might be called learning societies that occurred around 1800 for Western economies and more recently for those in Asia appears to have had a far, far greater impact on human well-being than improvements in allocative efficiency or resource accumulation. The fact that technological change, innovation, is at the core of these increases in standard of living was recognized by one of the great great economists of the first part of the last century, Joseph Schumpeter. But interestingly, his work, while widely discussed, has never been part of the mainstream in economics. Those of you who took standard economics course, they might have had a paragraph about him, but he has not been part, this emphasis on the importance of learning was really shunted aside. This is actually quite remarkable because just about 60 years ago, my own teacher, Robert Solow, who got a Nobel Prize for his work in this area, actually attempted to quantify what fraction of the increases in standard of living, he was only looking over the last 80 years, but still that was a long time, what fraction of the increases in standard of living were due to capital accumulation on the one hand, and what fraction was due to learning broadly understood. And basically his conclusion was that something like 70-80% was due to learning. Well, the next question is, what caused this dramatic change from thousands of years of stagnation, from a society without learning to one that did? And as we look around, what were the critical historical events that were going on around the time at which this sudden change in the pace of learning occurred, I think the single event that stands out is the Scottish Enlightenment. And I think it's something that here in Scotland you ought to recognize how important that was, not only for Scotland, but for the entire world. And actually, Edinburgh played a very important role in the Scottish Enlightenment. Of various places in the city, you have statues to some of your great heroes, including the people like Hume and Adam Smith. But these are really people who played an important role in transforming the entire world, and transforming, I should say, for the better, because there are often people who transform things for the worse. So the question then is, what were the ingredients, what were the aspects of the Scottish Enlightenment which plays such a vital role? And obviously in this short talk, I can't really do justice to that. But obviously one important aspect of this was recognizing that change was possible. If you read the history of medieval, Middle Ages, the idea of progress was a foreign idea. It was not an idea who had yet been invented. It's an idea that we take for granted, but it was an idea that was really invented in the Scottish Enlightenment and became universally accepted. Another important aspect of this was, that I'll come back to a little bit later on, is questioning authority. Although there was some debate about which authorities to question, and earlier periods, some authorities were viewed not to be questioned, and other authorities it could be questioned. But the third important ingredient was the scientific method. a scientific method that provided a systematic way of figuring out how to improve productivity. Obviously, once one engages in this kind of historical analysis, there are further questions that one wants to ask. What caused the Scottish Enlightenment? That's obviously a deep historical question that would be a subject of its own lecture. But I think one thing is clear, and I'm going to come back to that later, and that's education. There are some remarkable things about Scotland in this period that many of you may not know. Even at that early stage, Scotland had been committed to the idea of, I won't say universal education, but widespread education. So even 250 years ago, the male literacy rate in Scotland was 75%. This is really remarkable because we are striving in the developing countries to get numbers anywhere close to this. And to show you the difference between Scotland and your neighbor to the south, at that time, the male literacy rate was 50% higher than in England. But it's not just the broad scale minimum level of literacy that made a difference. Equally, and perhaps even more important, was access to tertiary education, to university education. As you know, that's an issue that is being widely debated, and Scotland and England have been going in absolutely the opposite direction. Scotland has been trying to make sure that there is universal access to education, no matter how poor you are, your parents are, and with free tuition. England, for reasons that I do not understand, well, I could give you a political economy analysis, but has been going in the opposite direction, saying that education, university education, should be something for the elite. They've been striving to increase inequality and have succeeded very remarkably in achieving an increase in inequality. Within the OECD, England, the UK as a whole, used to be in the middle of the pack. And as they have followed the American model, they have now achieved second rank in the advanced world. They haven't yet achieved the level of inequality that America has, but they are striving for it assiduously. And with the current ambitions of the Cameron government, they have every hope of a success. Well, this debate, which is a really important aspect of a society's philosophy, is a debate that goes back 250 years ago. 250 years ago, the cost of university education in Scotland was 1/10 of that at Oxford and Cambridge. So you can see that there are long historical antecedents to this debate. This is important. It's not just a question of numbers of tuition, because it changes the nature of society. And it was this widespread access to education, and including access to university education. It wasn't a world of equal opportunity, but it was a world of more opportunity than south of the border. And I believe that kind of widespread education of the citizenry played an absolutely central role in the development of the Scottish Enlightenment. Well, if it is the case, as I believe very strongly, that it is learning that has given rise to the remarkable increases in standards of living over the last 250 years, there are strong implications. One implication is that one should focus one's analysis on the impact of policies on learning, on how do we enhance the ability, how do we create a learning society. That should really be the focus of analysis. In the case of developing countries, the focus should be on the diffusion of knowledge from developed to developing countries, recognizing that what separates developing from developed countries is as much a gap in knowledge as a gap in resources. This perspective on the nature of development was one that I tried to bring to the World Bank when I served as chief economist there. But even in developed countries, there are enormous gaps between best and average practices. The technology used by the most productive firms and the average, that gap is huge, and obviously the gap between the best and the worst is even larger. For those of you who studied economics, this has really important implications because the standard economics analysis begins with the concept of a production function. It begins with the assumption that everybody has shared knowledge about how to produce things. The issue of how do you disseminate knowledge from the best practice to the average to the least efficient firm is not a question that's even asked. It's just assumed that knowledge disseminates. But it's obviously the case that it doesn't. And this is just one example of the many aspects of what goes into creating a learning society. Creating a learning society is both about how do we move the frontier of our knowledge forward, but also how do we learn from each other? How do we make sure that the level of productivity of every citizen, every firm in society is the best that it can be? So, in short, successful and sustained growth requires creating a learning society. And of course, this is especially true in the 21st century as we move to a knowledge economy. There are many aspects of creating a learning society. We learn through research. Research like such as that goes on in the universities. But we also learn a great deal in the process of production. And that's an aspect, we call it learning by doing, that's often been ignored. And as I'll comment in a few minutes, has profound implications. If you don't produce steel, you're not going to learn how to produce steel. Nobody learns about producing steel by reading a textbook. The knowledge about the production of steel only resides in the steel mill. And you get better about producing steel, again, not by reading textbooks, but by producing. Now, of course, you have to have knowledge as you engage in the production process, as you have to have knowledge as you think about as you see what goes on in a steel mill, about how to make that steel mill more efficient. But if you've never seen a steel mill and you're only reading a textbook, you'll never be able to make many advances in the production of steel. Not only do we learn by doing, of course, we have to learn how to learn. And that's another topic to which I'll come in a short while. So the creation of a learning society is affected by our institutions, not just the obvious ones like the patent system and the education system. And what I'm going to try to do in this talk is illustrate that with several examples. Before going into detail looking at these examples, I want to discuss two general principles. The first is that markets on their own will not do a good job in creating a learning society. This is a fundamental proposition because it means that laissez-faire market economies will not succeed. They will not be the most efficient. There needs to be systematic interventions by government. Adam Smith would have recognized this, an example of what has come to be called market failures, where markets do not necessarily produce efficient outcomes. But unfortunately, Adam Smith's latter-day followers, people who think of themselves as disciples of Adam Smith and have not read seriously his works, often do not recognize this. Let me reiterate. There is no theory that says that markets where innovations, where learning is important, are efficient either in the rate or direction of innovation, of learning. Quite the contrary, the presumption is that they are not. And one of the main chapters in my book, Creating a Learning Society, tries to show this. What I'll try to do this evening is to try to explain some of the reasons why this is so. There are several underlying problems. The first, and perhaps the easiest to understand, is that markets where innovation is important tend, for good reasons, to have limited competition. If we think about some of the most dynamic, innovative sectors of our economy, like the internet, we have faced a succession of monopolies. We had a monopoly in the operating system for PCs. And that monopoly did everything it could to squelch competition quite successfully and was convicted of engaging in anti-competitive practices in Asia, America, and in Europe. It was told to stop those practices, but it at first thumbed its said, you know, go away to the government. Eventually, the government was effective in stopping some of those practices, but the built-in distortions persisted even to this day, even after the worst of those practices were stopped. In case any of you don't know who I'm talking about, we're talking about Microsoft. But if you look at industry after industry, unless there is strong government intervention, you wind up with strong concentrations of market power. We see this in the area of search engines today. We could go through field after field, and it's evident, and it's almost always been the case. The second is that innovation is risky. And these are risks that cannot be insured, again, for good reasons. Reasons that are explained by the theory of asymmetric information to which you referred earlier. You know, you can't go to an insurance company and say, I want to buy insurance against the risk that my research is going to be a failure. The insurance company would know that you would know better about whether your research was going to be successful. And besides, it would know that if it insured you, you would have no incentive to succeed. So, in practice, these are very big risks, but they are risks that are uninsurable by their very nature. But that means that firms which are naturally going to be risk averse will underinvest in these really, especially in the really big innovations. You know, the innovations like the development of the internet, innovations like the transistor and the laser. And these are innovations which have always been supported by government one way or another. Thirdly, and that's very much related, innovation requires investments. Sometimes these investments are very large. Capital markets are imperfect, that is to say, often hard to get capital. Again, especially for research, because unlike a building, a real estate, where you have a collateral, when you lend money for research and things don't work out, what are you going to seize? A bad idea? There's nothing to serve as collateral. And so you have financial markets. You know, Bernanke talked about a savings glut. Too much savings in the world, believe it or not. The problem wasn't a savings glut. The problem was, you know, we had huge needs for investment in research of how to develop new technologies to deal with global warming. Huge investments of needs for investments in other areas. But our financial sector wanted collateralized investment. It liked the idea of investing with collateral, building shoddy homes in the middle of the Nevada desert, but not investing in research. I'm exaggerating because there are small niches in the financial market that actually do support innovation. One of the big innovations in America is the venture capital industry, but it's a small, small fraction of our financial sector. Fourthly, there are important spillovers, what economists refer to as externalities, where others benefit. Knowledge is, moreover, what economists call a public good. This is a technical term. A public good, in the way economists use the term, is something where other people can benefit without taking away from you. That is, in contrast to a private good, like a chair, if you're sitting in the chair, no one else can sit out in it, at least not comfortably. But if I tell you something that I know, now you know it, but I still know it. Thomas Jefferson, who was the third president of the United States and a product of the Enlightenment, put it much more poetically than economists can put these things. He said, knowledge was like a candle. When one candle lights the other, it doesn't diminish from the light of the first candle. Well, that's great. That's great news, but it has a problem. Economic principles are that you're supposed to charge marginal cost. If there's no cost to somebody using information, if it doesn't detract, then the cost you ought to charge zero. But if you charge zero, you're not going to get enough revenue to pay for the production of the good. So in a sense, what this says is that because knowledge is a public good, it cannot be simultaneously used and produced efficiently. If it's produced at the efficient level, it could only be privately produced at the efficient level if you privatize it and stop others from using it. But if you charge the efficient price, which is zero, for the use of the knowledge, then it has to be produced publicly. So that says one way or another, efficient production and utilization of knowledge ought to involve some role for government. And obviously we recognize that no one really thinks that the private sector should be engaged in producing basic knowledge. It's really produced by our universities, by our think tanks. Where did the discovery of DNA occur? Was it a private pharmaceutical company that discovered DNA, which has been the basis of so much of the advances in our understanding? No, it was government. And even the decoding of DNA, the human genome, was a public enterprise. Next, some of the private returns to innovation consist of appropriating returns that others would have received, what is sometimes called rank stealing. Private returns in some areas, in fact, as a result, exceed social return. The obvious example, again, are in the pharmaceutical area, where Me Too drugs. Somebody invents an important drug. What do other people do? They immediately try, it's protected by a patent. They do a lot of research to discover another drug that's very similar to the first drug. That second drug may have very little social value, a little bit. I don't want to say zero, because there may be some people for whom the first drug has side effects and the second drug does not. But the real incentive for producing the second drug is to steal some of the ranks away, the profits away from the first firm. It is not motivated by a desire, by efficiency, a desire to have the optimal set of drugs. There are many other examples where the social return is much, much less than the private return. In fact, some cases the social return is negative. The obvious example is innovation in the financial sector. Paul Volcker, who was chairman of the Federal Reserve, once said that there was not a single American innovation in the financial sector that had had any effect, positive effect, on American productivity, except the ATM machine. And he was wrong, because the ATM machine was a British innovation, not an American one. The social return to an innovation for somebody doing research is the fact that you get the innovation earlier than it otherwise would have been. But that's not the private return. The private return is that if you can get there faster than anybody else, you get all the rents for yourself. And so there's no correspondence between the social and the private return. In that particular case, the private return can be very large. The social return can be actually negative. Let me give you one example in which this turned out to be the case. The world was engaged in an important global cooperative effort to decode the human genome. But then there was an American company in Utah called Myriad that realized that if it could get a patent on a certain gene, it could make a lot of profits. So it wasn't interested in decoding the whole human genome. That would have been too good for society, and it wasn't interested in that. It figured if it could get an important gene, it could extract a lot of monopoly profits. And it succeeded. It succeeded in getting the patents on two genes called on the BRAC, what are called the BRAC genes. If you have those two genes, the probability of getting breast cancer are well over 50%. So it's really important to know whether you have those genes. Because it should be obvious that if you know that you have those genes, you want to have close surveillance, a much closer surveillance, and take precautionary measures. What was the potential benefit? Well, they discovered the gene just a little bit faster than the Human Genome Project, so it got there a little bit earlier. But what was the cost? The cost was they decided to exercise their monopoly power ruthlessly. So Yale University discovered a better test for the existence of these, whether you have those genes. Myriad says, you can't use that test. Yale said, we'll give that test away for free because we want to make sure that people don't die. Myriad said, we're not interested in people dying. That's not our concern. If society is concerned about that, they'll give us $5,000 for every person. But if you give us that money, we'll do the test. If you don't, no test. The result of that, of course, was that their test was inferior to Yale's test, and they wouldn't use Yale's test. They insisted on using their own test. The result, of course, was that people did die where they misdiagnosed. Finally, just about a year ago, the U.S. Supreme Court said, you cannot patent somebody else's genes. And they said, this is not patentable. Well, I mention this because this is a horrific case where people actually died, but I also mention it because it shows a patent system out of kilter, but it shows also, and this is really the point, that the private returns have nothing to do with the social returns. That there were huge private returns, negative social returns. There's a final aspect which, again, people in Scotland ought to be sensitive to. One of the important historical events in Scotland was the enclosure movement. America benefited because a lot of people Scots were thrown off their land and they came to America and they made important contributions to our country. But in terms of the well-being of the people, they weren't very happy, at least at the time. It was privately profitable for some of the lords who were able to privatize the land, but it was not, you might say, a welfare-maximizing movement. Well, knowledge, patents do the same thing. Patents are enclosing the knowledge commons. They're privatizing knowledge. That's what you do with a patent. Well, in some cases it may be desirable, in other cases it may not, but the private return is from the enclosure. And a patent system encourages people to take out of the patent pool as much as they can and to put into the patent pool as little as they can. But what's the most important contribution, the most important determinant of the production of knowledge? It's prior knowledge. And by reducing the size of the knowledge pool and access to knowledge, actually, it reduces the flow of knowledge and the flow of innovation. Well, the bottom line of all of this, and I could go on, let me just give one more example. And that is a problem that is increasingly becoming rising, which are called patent trolls, holdups, and patent thickets. There are hundreds of thousands of patents in software, and anybody who writes a program almost surely intrudes onto somebody else's patent. If you spent your time reading all the patents, you wouldn't have any time to do research. The result of this is that somebody comes up with an important innovation, an important software program, important innovation in one form or another, and what happens? They get sued. Today in America, some estimate that we are spending more on lawyers, patent lawyers, than we are in research. And when you have a society that spends more on lawyers than on researchers, you obviously have a distorted economy. But even worse than that, you're not creating a learning society. You're impeding the flow of knowledge. I was involved actually in a really interesting case involving Intel chips, and it actually shows the complexity of the modern globalized economy and the perversity of some of our laws. We have a law that says that if somebody has violated an American company's intellectual property, you can go to the court and get an injunction to make sure it's not imported into the United States. You could understand the reasoning behind this. You don't want somebody abroad stealing American intellectual property and bringing the goods into the United States. Well, to see how that has been, that law that had some logic at some point has become totally abused, a couple of years ago, a very small American company that had spent maybe a couple million dollars doing research and about much more than that on lawyers. We call these patent trolls. They're basically legal firms, not research firms. Sued Intel. It said that Intel's advanced processing chips violated their intellectual property. Intel had spent billions of dollars to develop the chip. And they said, never mind the fact that we spent only a couple million at most. Never mind that, we have a patent, and unless Intel gives us a whopping payment, we won't allow those Intel chips into America. Now you say, Intel is an American company. What do you mean about allow the American company to bring American chips into America? Well, that illustrates the complexity of the global supply chain. The innovation was done in America. The basic wafers of the chips are made in America. So this is actually manufacturing goes on in America, but the assembly of the wafers into chips occurs in Asia. So we ship the wafers back into Asia, and then we bring them back into the United States. They said, you can't bring them back into the United States. And they tried, because all of Apple computers use these chips, they said, no advanced processing chips into America, no Apple computers in America, and none of the advanced HP computers in America. Now, in this particular case, my role was a very simple one. I simply had to assess, was this good for America? was this in the national interest? There was a little loophole in our legislation that says this exclusion from America could be suspended if it was not in the American interest. But that particular clause had only been invoked four times in 40 years. So the standard was extraordinarily high. Well, we did succeed, and America was saved from this patent troll. But this is just one of many examples of how innovations of the wrong kind can actually impede innovation, the innovation process. Finally, really important, the basis of a learning society is an open society. And I will come back to that over and over again. It's an open society. Why are universities so successful? They have a really open architecture. People talk all the time. You know, yes, there's a little bit of people worrying about whether somebody will steal their ideas, and I don't want to say that we are all uninterested in getting credit for our work, but it's basically a very open society. But a patent system, I'll come back to that in a minute, a patent system works to the opposite. It encourages a closed society, not sharing ideas. So the bottom line out of all this is markets, especially markets when they're a patent system, won't be efficient in the allocation of innovation. And this, of course, is especially true, you know, if prices are distorted. And prices are distorted in many different areas. In the environment, we underprice environmental resources. In the case of labor, where there's high unemployment, we don't price resources. There are market failures not only in the level of investment, but also in the pattern. So the basic lesson that comes out of this is something that is also something that came out of my work in the economics of imperfect information. The most important theorem in economics, the most important insight in economics, was that of Adam Smith. And that was that the pursuit of self-interest would lead, as if by an invisible hand, to the well-being of society. Really an important idea. Unfortunately, it's not true. The reason the invisible hand often seems invisible is that it's not there. And we have to understand markets do have an important role, but we have to understand the limits when they don't work as well as when they do. So that's the first idea that I think that one has to bear in mind, that markets don't work, there's a need for government intervention. The second is thinking about the effects of policies on learning often leads to one to different views about policy from those associated with standard models. For instance, what are often called the Washington consensus policies. Many of these policies actually impede learning. So the basic point I want to emphasize is, if it is the case, as I've argued, that the increases in standard of living are a result of learning, then the focus of policy ought to be, how do we create a learning society? What can we do to facilitate learning? What can we do that impedes learning? So if we begin with this view, let me just, you can see that these have can have very different ramifications. So I've already given one example. A poorly designed intellectual property regime can actually impede learning because it encourages secrecy. It encourages not sharing. And so one has to very carefully design policy, taking into account the impacts on learning. I'll give a couple more examples as I go through. I'm going to talk about three areas now where these issues are very important. The first is, and I'll do it fairly briefly because I want to keep open some time for questions. The first area I'm going to talk about are something called industrial policies. Industrial policies is a broad term that's used to describe policies that governments undertake to encourage or discourage, but particularly to encourage some industry or some technology rather than others. Now, the subject of industrial policy, and let me make clear, it's not just about industry as we classically understand it. You could have an industrial policy to encourage renewable energy. You could have industrial policy to encourage the education sector. You could have, all I'm using the term industrial policy is to mean that the government is taking an active role to shape the economy. Now, it used to be that in some market fundamentalist views that are popular in some places, these kinds of policies were looked upon with a great deal of skepticism, great deal of criticism. One of my predecessors as chairman of the Council of Economic Advisors was quoted as saying, it didn't matter whether a country produced potato chips or computer chips. His view was, let the market determine what it produces. Don't interfere. That view was reflected in the advice that the IMF and World Bank gave to Korea many years ago, as it 40 years ago, it was began its process of development after the Korean War. Their advice to Korea, they said to Korea, your comparative advantage is growing rice. So they told Korea, stick to your knitting, grow rice. Korea said, thank you, but no thank you. They realized that even if they became the best rice grower in the world, competitive with Thailand, they would still be poor. They would not be an advanced country. They would be a poor agricultural economy. So they defied the advice of the IMF and the World Bank, and they said the only way that we are going to become an industrial economy is to become an industrial economy. The only way we're going to learn how to produce steel or to produce other chips or to produce cars is to begin by producing them. And that will necessitate trade restrictions, subsidies, active government involvement, shifting the economy. And I don't think anybody looking back on the history of Korea, including the Koreans, would say that was a mistake. Income per capita in Korea increased eightfold in the succeeding 30 years. A pace of increase in standards of living that was almost unheard of historically. They learned how to produce chips, to produce cars, to produce steel. They learned all these things, but they learned it by doing. They didn't begin having steel mills that were more efficient than any American steel mill. They didn't begin that way, but they would not have wound up with steel mills that were more efficient than any American steel mill if they hadn't begun by producing steel. So these policies have worked. In fact, almost no country has really been successful without such policies. And in fact, almost all countries have these policies. It's just that some countries don't know it. And when you don't have open discussions about the direction in which you're shifting the economy, pushing the economy gets pushed by special interest. So I would argue that every country has an industrial policy, but sometimes that industrial policy is basically shaped by special interest. Well, let me take it as an example of the United States. We had an industrial policy, which was, let's encourage a reckless financial sector. you can say, ask the question, why would a country choose to have that? We didn't choose to have it. We had a political process which allowed the financial sector undue political influence, and that's what we got, and we never had an open discussion. Let me just give you a couple examples of how we shifted resources into this sector, which had such a devastating effect on our economy and the world economy. One element is it's every aspect of a country's legal framework and how they're implemented. So one example, bankruptcy law, usually looked at, fairly arcane example. Bankruptcy law specifies what happens when a debtor can't meet all its obligations to its creditors. Key issue in bankruptcy law, who gets first claim? In every civilized world, there's a clear understanding of who should get first claim. Workers. Workers have given their labor. They can't say to the firm, I want it back now. You know, once you've given your time, it's gone. You can't get it back. And that's, you know, and a rule of law is not just a law. So we have to remember, a rule of law is about protecting those who otherwise can't defend for themselves. And the workers typically can't defend for themselves. So that's why every civilized society gives first precedence to workers, not America. Who gets first claim? The risky derivatives, those products, remember AIG? U.S. government wound up giving AIG $150 billion to one company, more money than we had spent on welfare for all of our citizens for a decade, went to one company, corporate welfare, to the very people who complained about welfare for poor people. And we had a legal framework that encouraged these derivatives because they said to them, to everybody, don't worry, if the company goes bankrupt because of the derivatives, the derivatives get paid first. Meanwhile, student loans can't be discharged even in bankruptcy. When I go around my book, Price of Inequality, some of the most poignant stories I hear are from parents who co-signed the loan with their children, and the children die, accident or disease, and the parents cannot get rid of those loans, even if they go bankrupt. You can discharge your debt for a yacht, but not for a student loan. So you talk about creating a learning society, we have a legal framework that discourages people taking the risk of investment in education, but encourages them to go into the financial sector or to buy a yacht. That's an industrial policy, but a misshapen one. Or to give another example of how our legal framework helps do this, we have a tax law that taxes speculators a third of the rate at which it taxes people who work for a living. I testified to Congress, and they asked me, how can we explain to our constituents why a plumber in my district comes and asks me, why does somebody on Wall Street pay a third of the tax for the same income that I do, that I have to work, I work long hours and work hard? It was a rhetorical question because we all knew the answer. There was no justification other than the influence of Wall Street. Well, those are industrial policies because they shape our economy. 8% of our GDP was in the financial sector before the crisis. The best, most talented people of our universities, I saw it every day and it broke my heart, were going into finance rather than into doing real research or into business or into other activities where they would create something. So the bottom line, what I want to make is that industrial policies can help shape the economy, can help move the economy towards a learning society, can identify sectors where there are more learning potentials and learning spillovers to other sectors, and therefore help create more of a learning society. This view on industrial policies that I've just articulated has now become much more mainstream. Not in certain quarters, particularly south of the border, but it is very much becoming part of the mainstream. Here in Scotland, there's a real concern about shifting the economy to creating more of a learning society, shifting the economy to develop renewable energy, to make use of the tidal waves. These are examples of what may turn out to be very successful industrial policies. But even the World Bank has now recognized, have changed its course, and realized that industrial policies are important. And the chief economist of the World Bank over the last 5 years made it the centerpiece of his own agenda. And in spite of that, in many quarters, there's resistance. The second area I wanted to discuss very briefly is intellectual property. I've already talked about the main aspects of that. As I said, intellectual property has costs and benefits. It restricts the use of knowledge. It creates monopoly power by giving exclusive use to one person. If it's well designed, it can help incentivize innovation. But as I suggested in my earlier remarks, if it's not well designed, it can actually thwart innovation. And historically, it's played a very ambiguous role. I gave some examples where there have been really serious adverse effects. There are many others if we look at the record. For instance, one example was development of the airplane. You might all know probably the story of the Wright brothers. Kitty Hawk, 1903, quote, the invention of the airplane. Actually, it's an interesting example because when I've talked about that in my class, there's always a student from Brazil that raises their hand and points out that it was a Brazilian who discovered, who made the invention 50 years earlier, but the patent officer in the United States didn't know that. But the patent office made a mistake, well, not a mistake, they gave two patents. They gave a patent not only to the Wright brothers, but to somebody else. And in the succeeding years, those two holders of patents fought against each other, and anybody else that wanted to develop the airplane had to pay both of them, and of course they couldn't do that, and so there was no development of the airplane. And it wasn't until World War I where the United States government decided it was more important to drop bombs from the air than to recognize intellectual property rights, that basically the U.S. government seized the patents, said we're going to decide who gets the returns, and it was only after that that the American airplane industry developed in America. Well, there are many other examples, including the car industry, where patents have had a very negative effect. Henry Ford would not have been able, he was accused of violating a patent. And because the holder of the patent, a very peculiar patent that was given for all four-wheel self-propelled vehicles, and the owner of the patent was not really interested in innovation, it was really interested in creating a cartel. And the business model of the cartel was high prices. And that was a business model very different from that of Henry Ford, whose view was, let's create a product, a car, that anybody could afford. Not anybody, but could be a people's car. Of course, that was before global warming. You know, in some ways, I wish he hadn't done that. But it was only after very serious litigation that he was able to disqualify the previous patent, and it was only after that he was able to market his car. Well, With poorly designed intellectual property regime, the dynamic benefits can be much less than the cost and actually impede creating of a learning society. And these adverse effects are obviously especially significant when it comes to areas like health. The bottom line is, as we think about intellectual property, we have to think about not the issue that you hear from the pharmaceutical industry, which is the stronger the intellectual property regime, the better. We have to think of a balanced intellectual property regime that helps create a learning society. The final area I want to talk about very quickly is education. It's obviously central to creating a learning society. The nature of the education system needs to focus on learning to learn, lifelong learning, needs to recognize that only a small part of learning occurs in formal schooling. And we have to understand the role of formal schooling versus lifelong learning, with the relationship changing with increasing pace of innovation and changes in the labor market, and changing with the ability to access knowledge on the internet. With the internet, the essential problem is not, you know, our old model was stuff the brain with as much knowledge, recognizing that they weren't going to learn anything more after they leave school. Today, we know that everybody has access to an enormous amount of knowledge on the internet. So the real issue is not stuffing the brain with knowledge, but learning, teaching them how to access that knowledge, evaluate that knowledge, put that knowledge into a theoretical framework that they can understand. There have been very fundamental changes in the labor market, which have changed the nature of education on the job. It used to be that people often had the same job for years and years, for a lifetime. Now, job turnover is very large. The average person in America has about a job lasts less than 7 years. And when you have a job for a short period of time, the employer is not going to be as willing to invest in formal education as was previously the case. And so we have to think anew about how do we design an education system. There are new opportunities created by the internet, but new challenges created by the changing labor market. I want to make two concluding remarks before I open this up to question. The first has to do with the observation that I made in the beginning, is that no, not all innovation is welfare increasing. I gave some examples before, like in the financial sector. And that opens up the question, innovation to what end? Well, much of the innovation in advanced industrial countries has been directed towards saving labor. But in many countries, the problem today is unemployment. And saving labor, reducing the demand for labor, creates more unemployment. The real scarcity in our society today is the environment. That is the scarce resource. But we don't price the environment, so there's no incentive to protect the environment. So while labor-saving innovations create a negative externality, there are enormous social benefits which are not appropriated from environmental innovations which help protect the environment. So we need a new model of innovation which focuses more on protecting the environment, less on saving labor. More broadly, as I said many times, what matters is not GDP, but the quality of life, well-being, and individual capability. And what that entails and how it can be increased should and can be a subject of rational inquiry. And this, of course, was the focus of the International Commission on the Measurement of Economic Performance and Social Progress that I chaired. The second brief comment I want to make in conclusion has to do with democracy and the creation of a learning society. The Enlightenment, creating a learning society, and democracy have always been closely linked. That's partly because science questions authority, and so does democracy. In the United States, in spite of the fact that our success has been based on technology and science, there is an increasingly anti-scientific mentality. There's skepticism about global warming and evolution. There is a as one of my friends put it, there is a constant process of relitigating the Enlightenment. There's a decreasing budgetary support for science. These failures are cause and consequence of a failure to create the kind of learning society that is needed for long-term success, except among a relatively small elite. And this is an important part of trying to understand the growing inequality in America. The growing inequality in America is associated with a failed education system that provides an absolutely first-rate education to the top and a mediocre education to the rest, that provides enormous opportunities if you are smart enough to choose the right parents, and that means rich parents. But if you are foolish enough to choose poor parents, your ability to get access to the kind of education that would lead you to be able to live up to your potential is nil, or is very, very small. The result of this is closely related to the country's growing inequality, to the point where the U.S. has become the most unequal society among the vast countries, and among the vast countries, among those with the least equality of opportunity. The fact is that the notion of the American dream, that America is a land of opportunity, from a statistical point of view, is a myth. My critique of non-inclusive growth, though, goes beyond that it's a waste of a country's most valuable resource, its human talent, its failure to ensure that everyone lives up to his or her abilities. There is an important political economy dimension. Government, as I have said repeatedly, needs to play an important role in an economy in which learning is central, correcting pervasive market failures, and especially creating a learning society. In a society with very little inequality, the only role of the state is to provide collective goods and correct market failures. When there are large inequalities, interests differ. Distributive battles inevitably rage. To prevent redistribution, the role of government is circumscribed. But in circumscribing government, the ability to perform positive roles is also circumscribed. Let me return in conclusion to the theme I raised at the beginning of this lecture, the role of the Scottish Enlightenment in launching the changes in mindsets that were essential in creating the learning society that in turn was essential in the creases of standard living that sets apart the last two centuries from the millennia that preceded. I've explained both the role of creating a learning society, increasing standards of living, and why markets won't do this on their own. Some governments have recognized this more than others. Some governments have set forth policies to create inclusive learning societies. Scotland is one of those. The direction has taken stand in marked contrast to those further south. Free university education for all Scottish citizens, industrial policies to address the pivotal issues of global warming. And this leads me to the final observation, an optimism about the possibility of a new era, for Scotland that has been opening what might be come to be called the new Scottish Enlightenment. Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you so much for that magnificent talk. I'm now going to open the floor to questions. Can I just say before I do the usual stuff, please, there's roving mics around, so wait for one to come to you. Can you, if you wouldn't mind, just introducing yourself, saying who you are, and if you could keep questions reasonably brief, that'd be good as well. And we might take three? Do you prefer in groups of threes?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, that's right. Okay, gentleman over there, please. Gentleman here. So if you could both, and then anyone else in the front?
Thank you, Professor. Professor Joe Goldberg.
There we go. Good. Professor Joe Goldblatt, Queen Margaret University in Edinburgh, and thank you for your kind comments about our adopted country of Scotland. I wanted to ask you, what do you believe, since you've talked about creating a learning society, would be the economic and political levers essential for Scotland to bring about what you've described as a second era of enlightenment? What economic and political leaders would we need to stimulate creativity, innovation, and enterprise? Thank you.
Great, thank you. And this gentleman here, and then if you wouldn't mind passing the mic to the gentleman there with the black shirt.
Professor, my name is Thomas Ward. It's amazing how successful the first Scottish Enlightenment was, considering that it was carried out at a time of union with the rest of the UK at the time. But just leaving that thought on the table for now, my question is slightly different. You've got a very interesting analysis of the importance of externalities and therefore the theoretical very strong case for some government intervention in markets for reasons, for important reasons of social welfare. When we look at the empirical evidence from around the world, though, of the effectiveness of government intervention in markets, it's, I think the kindest word you can find for it is to say it's mixed. How do we make government interventions more effective and less liable to be captured, for example, by special interests? Because it may be quite a long time before we have rioting on the streets in favor of fairer patent laws.
Great. And finally.
Professor Martin McAdam, I'm chief executive of a company here in Edinburgh that develops a wave energy device. But my question is in relation to the cost of innovation. And you talked about market failures, but pharmaceutical companies, for example, they do spend a huge amount on research and development, and they are entitled to a fair return of that. So where is that balance in terms of the return versus what's good for society, or is there a measure that we could use there?
Those are all good questions. Let me begin with the second one, because I think it, in a way, goes to the heart of the evidence is that there are failures in industrial policy, but there are also failures in every other policy, like monetary policy. I haven't heard anybody saying we ought to give up on central banks because the U.S. Central Bank or the U.K. Central Bank really, really failed badly at enormous cost. What you hope the outcome of those very serious failures is that we learn from that and hopefully going forward say, let's avoid the failures and try to make sure that we learn how to do it better. So there's a learning process in policy, just like there's a learning process in production. And if we look about that from this learning perspective, we see lots and lots of successes from which we can learn. And if you look at all of the countries that are being successful, almost all of the countries have, it one way or another, had successful industrial policies. That doesn't mean that they haven't at the same time had failures. You know, so if I look at the United States, I would say that we are the product of really successful industrial policies. The internet, but the first beginning of telecommunication actually was a US investment in the first telegraph line. Agriculture, the reason that today, in part, that we have, you know, used to be in the 19th century, 70% of labor was in production of the food. Now, 2 or 3% of the population produces more food than even an obese society can consume. Why is that? Largely because of the research, research that was done in government-funded universities and government extension services to bring that knowledge to the individual farmer throughout the country. I could go on, the development of the computer, the basic idea is the Turing machine, supported during the war by the UK government. So we can go on and say that almost every success, every big innovation has been government supported. So yes, there are failures, absolutely right. And I could give a long list of the failures, but the real lesson is, how do we create institutional structures that make the ratio of the successes to the failures larger? One thing that makes the analysis of industrial policy particularly difficult is that doing research is like drilling for oil. You know that you're not going, if you do it right, you know that you're not going to have every well successful. When I say that is, optimal investment involves risk-taking, and that means undertaking some research projects that are risky. And what does risk mean? Some chance of failure. So somebody is always going to point out, oh, you spent money on something that was a failure. Nobody says to an oil company, oh, you drilled a well that was dry. Answer, obviously it drilled a well. You know, that's the nature of the business model. And that's the nature of the business model of research. Now, the problem is we have to make sure that we increase the probabilities of success and reduce the probabilities of failure. Some of the ideas that I was trying to discuss are some of the ways of developing checks against failure, making it more open so that it doesn't get captured by special interests. And that's really an important aspect of it. Second example, in general, at least my co-author, Bruce Greenwald, in this book, interestingly, is very conservative. But we agree on the economics of that there are really important market failures. He is more skeptical of the ability of government, but he says, look, there are some broad-based policies like those that China undertake in leading to a lower exchange rate that makes manufacturing more competitive, that then has the effect of encouraging the broad sectors of the economy that are more innovative. And he likes the individual firm. That means the individual firm that succeeds chooses itself. In the case of Japan and many of the other East Asian countries, what they did is to say, you have to put up your own equity. We'll lend you, but we'll only lend to you if you've proven that you are successful by success in export markets. So they were very careful in framing criteria that avoided some of the failures of political economy in other countries. There's a long list of other techniques that can be used to reduce the probability of failure and increase the probability of success. But I want to come back to the general point I made. Every country has industrial policies because you cannot escape the role of shaping the economy. It's going to be affected by the roads you built, the ports you create, the nature of your education system. Whatever you do, it shapes the economy. Only question is, do you think about it? And so what I'm calling for is a little bit more thought to try to shape it into more of a learning society. Well, that goes a little bit to the question of, you know, what are the levers that government has? And, you know, there are lots of levers. Once you start looking at things through the prism, through the learning society, creating a learning society lens, you see that every policy can have some effect. That's why I gave the example of bankruptcy policy, where unintentionally our bankruptcy law helped shape our economy in ways that were antithetical to a learning society. Well, the most important, I think, are policies like education policy. That's why I think universal access to education is so important. Certain aspects of immigration policy can be important. If you open your doors to bright people from other countries to your universities, then when they graduate, say, I'm sorry, you have to leave, you're not creating as innovative economy, a learning economy, as you otherwise could have. So even the structure of immigration policy can have effects. But industrial policies are other examples Final question about pharmaceutical. Yes, I mean, you have to get a fair return. I think you have to be very careful about thinking about how you incentivize. I mean, clearly you have to incentivize. An example of an alternative framework to the patent system is an idea which the Royal Society of Arts has actually supported over several hundred years, which is the offering of prizes. And the patent system is a prize. The first person gets a prize of monopoly power. It's not a very efficient prize system because the prize is the right to distort the market. There's a better prize system. You can talk about what is the value of the invention and say, if you come up with a drug that cures malaria, here's a prize of a couple billion dollars. If you come up with a Me Too drug, here's a small prize. There's some value to it, but it's not enormous. Actually, this kind of idea of how you incentivize the invention of drugs is an idea that's been endorsed by the WHO. And on a regular basis, Senator Saunders introduces legislation into the U.S. Senate that introduced this kind of system. I've testified in Congress in support of this as an alternative way of incentivizing. Now, it isn't a solution for all kinds of things, because it's a good solution for drugs where you know what the value of getting a cure for cancer of a particular type. You can assess the benefits, but no one would have thought of the idea of postums, for instance. You know, so you're not, it's not a solution to everything. It's an important solution, say, to some problems of a long-lived, low-weight battery. That's, you know, we all know the importance of doing that. But there are many, many ideas that really take real creativity in which the patent system will play an important role. Let me just say one more remark about the alleged cost of pharmaceuticals, the spending on innovation. You know, I mentioned before that US companies spend more on lawyers than they do on research. But the lawyers are often included in the research budget. So, advertising and marketing and the two get intertwined. So when pharmaceutical companies test a drug, they pay many doctors to do the test, not because they think the doctor in Podunk is a good researcher who, you know, it's really important to get a sample of people in Podunk and to make sure that the drug works against people who live in that particular latitude or longitude. No, they do that because they want to get the buy-in of that doctor as part of, quote, the research experiment. He can advertise that with his customers, with his patients, and he then prescribes that with his patients. There are much more efficient ways of testing drugs. Most of the research money goes into testing. You know, there are basically three stages. The basic research goes on in government labs and university labs. Then there's the intermediate stage, and then there's the testing stage. This is really a side to the Learning Society, but it's an important point. Who would think that the best way of testing a drug is to have the person who is going to make the profit if the test is successful do the testing himself? It's not a good way of doing it. The conflicts of interest are obvious, and there have been many instances in which those have played out in a disastrous way. And there are better ways. I've written about this. Other people have written about this for that would bring down the cost enormously for testing and lead to a more efficient pharmaceutical industry.
Great. Thank you. Got some other questions identified. Lady there, a gentleman over there, and a gentleman in the back row.
Hi, thank you for your talk. I wanted to say something which is maybe a little bit challenging, but you did encourage us to be critical and challenging. And it is to do with this assumption that our policy on higher education and student fees is automatically redistributive. Now, in fact, what's happened in Scotland is since the graduate endowment was abolished in 2008, we haven't seen a big increase in students from poorer backgrounds. And the social profile of our institutions is actually very, very similar to that south of the border. In fact, Scotland has the lowest proportion of students from the most deprived backgrounds in higher education. I mean, one of the reasons, of course, for this is that in England, you don't pay up front. It's a postgraduate repayment system. In Scotland, the poorest students didn't actually pay the graduate endowment anyway. And the greater money for higher education has been found at the cost of reductions in schools and colleges, colleges in particular, catering for poorer students. So I do think that we do need to be critical of some of these measures that are presented as automatically social justice measures. When you look at them closely, that's not what they're delivering.
Great. Chap at the back. Keep it brief, please, if you wouldn't mind.
I'm Douglas Robertson from the University of Stirling. Very impressed by your justification of a public university system. But I wonder if we could maybe have explored a wee bit more, or whether you have explored in your book a wee bit more around the constraints on the construction of knowledge. Because I'm quite intrigued in social science that we seem to spend our time investigating the vested interests of those delivering services, and we seem to be very poor at actually ever asking those that receive them what their experience is. And we seem to have a different view in education as to what is legitimate knowledge and what is not legitimate knowledge. And I think if you're talking about a public education system and creating a learning society, I wonder what your views are on the knowledge mobilization agenda, which is developing in Canada, where all different aspects of knowledge are brought together on an equal basis because everybody has an input to make in that process. And perhaps the new enlightenment could actually develop a new way of thinking, because I think we're still stuck in an enlightenment construct of the 19th century in terms of academic research. Thank you.
Okay, gentlemen over there.
Navraj Singhali from Edinburgh Law School. I work mainly on climate change, and it strikes me that the great obstacle to effective action that you describe is path dependencies. And it seems to me that when you're talking about your laying out your manifesto, again, there are a series of very powerful path dependencies. There are industrial path dependencies, intellectual path dependencies, technical dependencies, which are in some senses mutually reinforcing. So the question is, how does, you outlined in the answer to the chap at the front earlier, what the levers are, but those levers still have to operate in the context of very powerful path dependencies. So how is it that we bring, that we overcome those and then start implementing policies that you describe? Thank you.
Okay, those were all hard questions. Let me begin. Let me begin on the question on university education. And I let me say, I agree very strongly that we ought to be looking at our success, our performance, in terms of how we are doing, and I say this is not just true of Scotland, but everywhere, both in the diversity of the enrollment and the diversity of graduation, and those are two different things. And maybe I'm very sensitive to the fact, that you can't solve all the problems just by focusing on university education. You really have to go back to year one. You have to begin with education at year one. And that means creating programs for childcare, beginning at year one and continuing on. The importance of this is being stressed, you know, research by Jim Heckman in economics. A lot of people have stressed the importance of, by the time they're 5 years old, those differences are, I don't want to say baked in, but almost baked in, and it's very hard to undo that. So it is true that student fees by themselves are not going to solve the problem. Let me just give you from the American perspective, again, to show how strong those biases, those problems are. Columbia, like the other Ivy League, fairly rich universities, have Nijsblind admission. That means we accept students without knowing anything about their economic background, their ability to pay, and then their parents fill out a form, and there's an assessment of what their parents can pay, and we pay for all the rest. Many students go to these very expensive $60,000 a year schools and pay nothing. And yet, because even though they're Nijsblind, and they really are Nijsblind, and the admissions committee makes their decision without knowing anything about what their parents can afford, leaning to trying to accept people from poor schools. They really, it's a deliberate policy to try to, if you come from one of the rich districts, you are going to have a harder time than if you come from a poor district. So they actually lean the other way. But knowing nothing about the parents' own ability to pay, only 8 to 9% of the students come from the bottom half of our population. So it's not money is not the problem. It's they haven't, by the time they've gotten to 18, gotten the background. I was a trustee of Amherst College. We actively recruited students from poor areas. We spent large amounts of money looking around, scouring the country for children with poor background to come to Amherst. And we succeeded a little bit. But I don't want to say we succeeded anywhere near like we would have wanted. Because in our mind, economic opportunity has really become the issue of the day. We had succeeded in Amherst in creating opportunity across races and ethnic groups 50 years ago. So much so that, and it actually had worked, so that we could fill a whole class with graduates of African Americans, with African Americans who were the children and grandchildren of people that we admitted 50 years ago. It's a real testimony to the success of affirmative action, but it is also testimony to the difficulties of economic opportunity. Now, I think that there are some serious efforts going on in the United States and elsewhere to address the problem of both enrollment and graduation, and in public schools, but it has to be done conscientiously. For instance, in Arizona State University, a very, very large American university, the president has committed himself to trying to create a university where enrollment and graduation is reflective of the population in Arizona, which is large ethnic Hispanic population, and he's almost succeeded. And he's done it by a real commitment. Interesting thing, put a lot of pressure on the faculty, and the really interesting thing is the faculty are all excited. Normally they don't like having all kinds of pressure, but they feel like they're part of a real mission. So it was a real exciting experience going down there and visiting them. Let me finally say, I there are many financial models by which you can ensure opportunity. I think, as I say, the key issue starts well before 18. Australia has a very successful program called income contingent loans that has worked very well. And that's another model that I would recommend to a lot of countries. Interestingly, they're having a very big fight over student loans, over their student fees, because they've have very strong regulation keeping the fees down, and they have a conservative government that's now trying to raise the fees and saying that they want to imitate the American model. And you could imagine a system that's worked very well for 20, 25 years and getting economic opportunity, a lot of people are very upset. And whether this will go through or not, I don't know. I think I want to answer the question about path dependency. I think everything I've said is very path dependent. Knowledge is path dependent. In the book, I give an example. For instance, path dependency just is another fancy way of saying history matters. And I give an example in the book of how the Black Plague, a historical event, nobody really planned it, actually had some very positive side effects, because one of the side effects is that it created a scarcity of labor, and that scarcity of labor really changed the nature of the dynamics of society in ways that were could not be reversed, and including instituted incentives for innovation. And once you learn something, when the wages go down, when wages go up, it encourages productivity. And actually, it was part of the beginning of the search for more productive technologies. When wages go down, people say, "Don't erase what they have learned." Knowledge is a real example of a path dependency. When you learn something, you don't unlearn it when things change. Well, that the recognition of path dependency really means that we have to think much more deeply about strategy. And in a way, the story I gave about Korea was about their recognizing that there's a path dependency. What they said is, if we stick with rice, we will never learn. If we switch to another path, our whole history will be different. So they mapped out two different histories. One is a history of staying, you know, they didn't fully know what was going to happen if they went off tried to get steel mills and other things. But they had a pretty good idea what would happen if they stayed with rice. And so they couldn't do a full strategic analysis, but they got enough of a view of strategy, a path dependency, to say going this industrial way was much more interesting. So inevitably we have to think about that. Now, the academic profession is very path dependent, is in spite of the fact that we believe we're engaged in learning, we're also very resistant to learning, or resistant to change. And it's just I won't try to defend it, but it is the nature of the profession, of all academic professions. Let me say, as an economist, I really feel it very strongly. Many of you may know that in 2008, we had a financial crisis. But many of my colleagues in the economics profession don't yet know this. And I've been trying to explain it to them, but their view is, well, you know, accidents happen, you know. And so they're on this path dependency where they learned when they were graduate students about perfect markets, and they're not willing to change the path. And I'm involved in an effort within economics called the Institute for New Economic Thinking, where we succeeded in getting some philanthropists to give us substantial amounts of money to try to help change the direction of the economics profession. Whether we'll succeed or not is an open question, but that there is a lot of resistance to rethinking what is going on. Then now, at the same time, while there's a lot of resistance, when you have big enough events, you do get some changes. So I don't want to say there's complete inertia. And by working strategically, one can sometimes affect some change. So an example is an institution that I've often been very critical of, which is the IMF. Some of you may know the book I wrote, Globalization and Its Discontents, was about some of the failures of the IMF. Well, that's an institution which did discover, recognize that there was a crisis in 2008, realized that their models had been badly flawed, and attempted to learn from that, and have succeeded, I think, in learning enormously. So when I talk about learning, remember I said before, it's not just learning about production, it's not just manufacturing learning, it's institutional learning. And they've succeeded enormously to the point where two of the things they've focused on in recent years are really revolutions. One of them is one of the big debates that we had back in 1997, they tried to change their charter to force countries to liberalize their capital markets, to allow short-term capital to move in and out freely. In 2010, they said that it was a good thing for countries to try to restrict the flow of capital. That we call them now, we don't call them capital controls, we call them capital account management techniques. But the idea, really a 180-degree turnaround. Second, they had never talked about inequality. You know, I jokingly said they had a good partnership with the World Bank. World Bank helped solve poverty. IMF helped create poverty. And the two of them working together kept themselves in business. Today, the IMF has said very, very forcefully that inequality has enormously adverse effects on economic performance and helps create instability. So that's, again, something that's real learning. So those are little glimmers of hope that even in areas where there are rigidities, if one fights the battle long enough, maybe you can get a little progress.
Yes. Great. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I think we should seize that moment of hope on that note of hope. And I know there are more questions out there, but we really should wind up. And so I'd like to invite, if I may, Professor Susan Deacon to come and say a vote of thanks.
I'm tempted to say, how do you follow any of that? But what I will say is that it is truly both my pleasure and an enormous privilege to propose this vote of thanks on behalf of all of you here tonight. Often in these occasions, the person standing in this slot gives this erudite synopsis of the lecture that we've just heard. Now, I'm pleased to say that time does not permit for me to even attempt to do that, but I am neither clever enough nor daft enough to try and do that when following a Nobel Prize-winning economist. What I will say is this, that perhaps now more than ever, we need to think, learn, and work together more than ever before to understand the world that we live in and to make it better. And to do that, we need people who can guide us, who can stimulate our thinking, who can inform and inspire us. People with great minds and good hearts. And it is a tremendous honor, I think, to have Professor Joseph Stiglitz with us here tonight, a man who unquestionably puts a very big tick in both these boxes. Now, we're all going to take many different things home from tonight's lecture. I will share just very briefly my own few take-home messages from tonight. First, a reminder, I think, of where Professor Stiglitz started, reminding us that we have to constantly question and challenge prevailing orthodoxies and assumptions, wherever they come from, be it in economics or indeed in our political system. And again, tonight, as he has across all of his work, he has shone a light on the limitations of markets and the many failures that we have all seen so plainly, particularly over recent years. But what he has also reminded us is that governments can and should act both to tackle inequality, but also to create the conditions for a learning society and for knowledge and innovation to flourish. And I'm very struck that he reminded us, perhaps inadvertently, not to think in some of the boxes that we often do, because he didn't talk to us tonight primarily about education policy, but about industrial policy and how learning needs to be embraced right across that spectrum. And last but not least, I think there was a big message in there about how we all have a shared responsibility to build a learning society and how learning needs to be embedded in our society and in the lives of our children from a very early age, and yes, of course, right through all the later stages of our education system. But rather than stand here and eulogise, and I could do that indefinitely, and rather than ask you simply to pay tribute to Professor Stiglitz by applauding his lecture tonight, as I'm sure you will, and or even buying his book, which I'm sure you also might, rather, I think the biggest compliment that we could pay to you tonight is to act on what we've heard. As has been alluded to frequently, this is an interesting time in this shiny wee country of ours. Whether we do stand on the brink of a new Scottish Enlightenment remains to be seen. But one thing's for sure, that whatever the outcome of that vote next month, we need to get better at thinking, working, and learning together. Learning by doing, learning from each other. Professor Stiglitz, you've been a good friend to Scotland. You've offered your wit and wisdom to us many times in the past. I hope you will continue to do so in the future as we go into that next chapter in our journey. It has been a real pleasure and an honour to have you here tonight. Please join with me in thanking Professor Stiglitz.